Again. So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another session of the Network Seminar Series hosted by the Center for Networked Intelligence at the Robert Bosch Center for Cyber-Physical Systems, IISc. Today's talk is by Professor Manas Khatua, and he'll be speaking on 6DISH IoT Network, Formation, Challenges, and Recent Advancements. Professor Manas Khatua is working as an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Guwahati, since May 2018. Prior to that, he was an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Jodhpur, from 2016 to 2018, and was a postdoctoral research fellow at Singapore University of Technology and Design from 2015 to 2016. He completed his PhD in wireless networks from IIT Kharagpur in 2016. He passed MTech in information technology from Bengal Engineering and Science University, Shippur, and BTech in computer science and engineering from University of Kalyani in 2007 and 2003, respectively. He was associated with Tata Consultancy Services for 2.5 years and worked as a lecturer in Bankura Unnayani Institute of Engineering for more than 2 years. His research interests include performance evaluation of communication protocols, Internet of Things, wireless networks, sensor networks, network security, cloud and edge computing, and cyber-physical systems. He is an author of many reputed international journal and conference publications. He is a member of IEEE and ACM. Before we move on to the talk, we'd like to request the audience to subscribe to our Google group for information on future talks. You can also visit our website for more details. I'll be pasting the links in the chat box. Please do check. Finally, we request the audience to keep your microphones on silent for the duration of the talk. And for questions, you may ask Professor Manas or type them in the chat box and we'll moderate it with him. Over to you, Professor Manas.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your introduction. And good afternoon to everyone who are participating online. Now, I will go straight on to the talk, which I have planned for today's session. That is 6DISH IoT network. And one specific aspect of it is the network formation, corresponding challenges, and the recent advancement in the same domain. So this is the outline of my presentation for today. At the beginning, I will just touch upon very briefly on IoT. This will help to understand the 6DISH network, because it may happen that many of us don't know what is this 6DISH, but IoT is well known. Everybody know this term, at least the basic idea at least. So that's why I will start from this known part, and then I will come to the specific type of IoT network. And then I will highlight few research issues corresponding to this network domain. And at the end, the recent advancement, that means what we have done basically in our department here. Along with me, few PhD research scholars are also working. They are working in different domain. One of them are working in this network formation domain. So what we have done so far, that is the few things I am going to explain briefly. So I have mentioned here 4 solutions, but if the time permits, then I will touch upon the 4, all the 4, otherwise as much as possible. And at the end, I will show just 1-2 slide, the IoT research lab, which I have established here. In fact, the lab is behind me here, just in my office. I have prepared this research lab, and this lab inside means using those devices, we are doing the experiment. And we have started already. But in many papers, we have used the testbed available access online. So that we have used FEET IoT lab testbed, many of you maybe know. So that we have used for evaluation, but yes, we have also started using this lab, which I have developed here. So first, what is the IoT? Everyone knows the concept of IoT. I will just tell that IoT is nothing but a network of physical objects. In these physical objects, the objects are initially designed, manufactured, not considering that they will be connected with the internet. But yes, nowadays, because of the development of many small components, many advanced technologies, those devices, those objects could also be connected with the internet if they have few additional components, few additional modules attached with that. So that's why those objects are called the smart objects, and IoT is nothing but the network of those smart objects. The basic objective of those smart objects is to sense the environment and give those collected data to the central server or the central entity who is either monitoring it or who is who wants to run those data, wants to perform the analysis to design new kind of solution or to extract new business output from that. Therefore, if we try to find out, minimize this part. Is it visible, the heading part?
Yes, it is.
Heading part is visible, right? Okay. So now if we try to find out where this IoT is applied, you will find it everywhere. I will just mention a few of them, starting from the wearable devices to smart appliances, in home appliances, to healthcare, and in industry as well. But yes, these are only few, very few you can say. It is applied in everywhere. If we see the global market of IoT, then you will see that it actually spreaded in all types of different tech segments, considering the consumer segment or business segment. So you will see that traditionally the industrial IoT, healthcare IoT, and smart city, these three segments actually applied this IoT extensively. That's why their market share is comparatively more than every other segment or every other modules. But yes, IoT is applied in every other areas also. Here I have mentioned again few of them. Now, how this IoT is working? If we try to understand a little bit technical view, then you will see that there are grossly three layers, we can say. At the bottom, there is a thin layer. This is the part, things layer. In the middle, we will find the edge layer. And at the top, we will see the cloud layer. So this things layer basically consist of different type of sensors, actuators, and many other smart objects also, or few relay node you can place. So those are forming multi-hop network, and as they don't have the enough resources, because the IoT nodes are considered as resource constrained devices, so they do not have enough resources to connect directly with the maybe the tower, if we use the cellular communication, if we use any other type of low power communication with the router or gateway. So directly, so that's why the multi-hub communication plays the role there. And then whatever they have collected, whatever they have gathered, whatever they have aggregated, that those data will be processed little bit. Not everything will be processed in the edge layer. So edge layer plays the role that real-time data collection and little bit analysis also, processing also. But if we need to analyze extensively, if we need all the data to be analyzed properly, then the algorithm, the protocol, which is required, is not possible to execute in the edge layer, because again, even though it is considered that edge layer consist of little bit more resources compared to the things layer, but still it is not enough. So in that respect, we forward the data to the cloud layer, where it is assumed that cloud layer will have enough resources. Whatever we want to do, we can do there. Whatever amount of resources are required, we can get there. So the data will be sensed. In brief, the data will be sensed in the things layer. It will go through the edge layer to the cloud layer, where it may be analyzed. Or if any monitoring is there, the person will monitor those data to give the feedback. And that feedback will come again following the reverse part. That is the traditional view of the IoT, how it is working. So in this, the things layer, here, whatever multi-hop network it is forming, this is basically with respect to IoT network. If we say, then it is basically low power and lossy network. Okay, this is not the kind of network we are using in internet, the TCP IP, for example, we are using right now, one type of network. And that that is this low power and lossy network is not of that kind of. So now, if we technically want to see that what are the different technologies are being used here, then we will find that there are many technologies, starting from embedded system to low power network, internet, big data, data analytics. So all are basically different technologies. And in this, the low power network, here I am concentrating. Here my research work, I am doing the research in this domain, and also today's presentation will be in this domain. Now the access technologies, if we want to see that, okay, if we want to connect the devices, then different types of access technologies are already available in the market. Sometimes you will find the another terminology that connectivity, connectivity technologies. So ultimately they are talking about the access technologies. So there are many more I have given here, few names, starting from Zigbee, LoRa, 6LoWPAN, sub 1 gigahertz. And these are now Wi-Fi, means IoT version of the Wi-Fi, which is Hello. And the existing one, the NFC, Bluetooth. And again, if we go to the cellular domain, then we will find NB-IoT and 5G. So all these are different technologies are already available. So that now which technologies are important or which technologies I should use, that will depend on the different requirement, and those requirement will be evaluated, or you can say analyzed by the different criteria, which are called communication criteria. For example, if I need to perform long range low power communication, then Zigbee is not the suitable one. In that case, maybe I have to go either LoRa, or I have to use the cellular based communication. Now this is the, requirement. The range is the requirement. So accordingly, I have to select. Now again, if I want to use the ISM band, then again I cannot use the cellular one, because cellular one does not provide the does not work in the unlicensed band. They need to have the licensed band. So we cannot use the 5G NB-IoT. So in that case, we have to use maybe Zigbee or LoRa. So such kind of things, some 1 gigahertz. So all these things we have to use. So in this way, according to the communication criteria, we have to decide. But there are many more. Now let us consider that, okay, inside a home, I have the IoT network established. This example, let us consider this example. Air quality index is monitored, and that is transmitted to the gateway. Smoke sensor is there, maybe temperature, humidity sensor is there. Okay, door sensor for security reason is there. So they are either connected through Bluetooth or maybe through Zigbee or any low power network. So they are connected to the IoT gateway in one hop in general sense, but yes, we could have the multi-hop also. Now, if you want to perform this monitoring remotely, then we need to have the internet working facility. So who will provide this internet working facility? So it may be through the traditional TCP/IP network, or maybe through the cellular based communication, 3G, 4G, 5G, whatever you want to, or maybe the LoRa. But yes, we need to have some additional thing which which can provide the internet working. So remote access means far away, or maybe two different homes are placed or geographically placed in far away. So then how they will be connected? In between, they need to provide some internet working facility. So that is the diagram is showing here that 3G, 4G or IP could be used. Wireless and wired, both are applicable. But now in this respect, if we want to have this internet working infrastructure, then the two scenario will come in picture. One is either we can utilize the existing one, which is already present, but I have shown in the previous slide, either cellular 3G, 4G or the IP, or we can utilize or we can deploy our new internet working infrastructure. So obviously the second option is costly. Capital expenditure will be high and overhead will be high. Nobody will prefer that one to deploy. Everybody will try to use the existing one because of not only the capital expenditure or not only the overhead. So because of the technical different advantages also. So key advantages of using this IP-based infrastructure, internet working infrastructure, we already know the advantages of IP. I have mentioned here few. It is open and very well standard. It is available everywhere. It's very much scalable. It is now there are sophisticated software, sophisticated protocols to manage it properly. Security is also up to a good extent. It is good. So this is IP-based communication is stable also. So these are many, many advantages for this IP. So people thought to use the traditional TCP/IP infrastructure for internet working. Now the question comes, because this low power network, which I have shown in that last layer. Okay, so that low power network is basically 802.15.4 based communication, or you can say the standard published by IEEE. So this is the low power and lossy network. And it has some attributes, it has some rules, regulations. Initially, it was not designed, keeping in mind that they will be connected with the TCP/IP, or in other words, I can say that TCP/IP also was not designed, keeping in mind that, okay, they will be connected with the low power network. Because we know that if we want to see this network protocol stack, then this data link layer and physical layer, in case of TCP/IP, we get it is Ethernet-based communication forward, or maybe the Wi-Fi-based communication, which are designed keeping in mind this TCP/IP, this whole protocol, communication protocol stack. But in this case, we have just designed this low power one here, and we wanted to utilize the existing one, these two. So this the question is coming that how to fit. So that question is actually answered by this adaptation layer. And the objective of this adaptation layer is to minimize or reduce the size, packet size, or you can say the header size, basically, traditionally header size. Because the network which is there, or the node which is there in the low power network, is constrained in nature. So that is the, and technically if you want to see, we'll see that this is 1 to 80 bytes, the minimum requirement for IPv6 packets here. And we know the encapsulation mechanism applied in this protocol stack. So data will be encapsulated here on UDP, so TCP, so here, this basically this whole packet will be encapsulated inside this frame, which this is corresponding to the data link layer and this is corresponding to the network layer. So now this size, minimum size of this IP packet is 1 to 80 byte, and maximum size of this MAC frame is 127 byte. It is drastically less, and it is very less compared to 1 to 80 bytes. So that is the problem. Even if we make a different small segment also, fragment also, then also the performance will be reduced. So that is the reason we need to have the another layer, adaptation layer in between. And this adaptation layer, the protocol corresponding to this adaptation layer is the 6LoWPAN. And this is shown here. And IEEE published this 802.15.4 version. and that works well. In fact, six-lopen, if we use the six-lopen network, then we'll see that application protocol directly connecting with the six-lopen, and they can directly communicate for providing the service, different types of service using the six-lopen network. Later on, what IEEE have observed, or the researcher has observed, that okay, this 802.15.4 MAC specification is not good enough. It has many disadvantages, and they have tried to avoid those disadvantages, reduce those disadvantages. They proposed the amendment, and that amendment basically modified version. Modified version is the E802.15.4 ETSCH, and this amendment fits well. But the problem again comes because of this TSCH. I will discuss a little bit on the TSCH, because you can understand from this name that 6TISCH is coming from here. So TSCH I will discuss later on. Let us consider for this slide that, okay, this is the protocol which is used in the data link layer. And this protocol needs, or this protocol works on time slotted, the TSCH full from, if you see, then you will see that a time slotted channel hopping. Okay, so sometimes in different books, you'll find time synchronized also, but the traditionally it is time slotted channel hopping. So time slotted, that means the communication is happening here based on the given time slot. So it is one kind of TDMA based approach, time division multiple access kind of approach. Time division multiple access approach. Now here the question comes that who is the person who will tell you that, okay, you use the slot one for node one, use the slot two for node two, use the slot three for node three. So that means we need to have some schedule who or some scheduling protocol which will give this information to this data link layer. And that is why we see another sublayer in between coming 6LoWPAN and 802.15.4, that is the 6 top sublayer. And the basic work of this sublayer is to provide this schedule to the MAC layer. Okay, so now with this idea, now I will say that what is this 6TISCH protocol, or in short, sometimes we call 6TIS. So this, what is this network? This network at the bottom, physical and MAC layer, it is using 802.15.4E, but in recent version, they have removed this UART because this was the amendment. Now it has become the original standard, 802.15.4, basically TSCH is there. This is the physical and MAC layer. And in the application layer, you can see there are different applications which were there in the TCP/IP also, HTTP is there, but specific application protocol corresponding to this IoT network is also there, which is COAP, or you can say this is the publication, this is the protocol developed by IETF. There are many other protocols also, for example, MQTT developed by IBM company. So that is there. There are many. For routing, it is basically RPL protocol, and RPL is running on the top of the IP protocol, IPv6 protocol. So that therefore you can say that in the RPL routing layer, IPv6 concept is also there. And already we have discussed about the adaptation layer, the requirement of the adaptation layer. There are many small protocols also there. So all these are at RFCs, you can see. So and from the year, this is year actually, basically years. So from these years, you can understand that this work is still going on. This type of all these works are going on in this domain. And in scheduling, or you can say the 6TI for providing this 6TISCH network. So this another management layer, sometimes it is called the scheduling layer, management layer. So this layer is there. Basically, this is sublayer. And in this sublayer, so one is this RFC 8180, minimal 6TISCH. This RFC talks about the network formation. And rest of the slides or rest of the presentation, I will focus only this RFC, this network formation part. Okay, so this is the traditional 6TiSCH protocol stack, which is used in 6TiSCH based IoT network. Now coming to the TSCH part. So this TSCH we need to understand a little bit so that the network formation challenges we will be able to understand, because network formation challenges, few challenges are coming from this TSCH mechanism. So what is this 802.15.4e? So basically it has taken few idea from existing protocols or existing technologies, wireless heart, so ISA 100.11. So these are the standard already there. So IEEE has taken idea from those standards. Now what idea they have taken? They have taken the time slotted access. They have taken the shared and dedicated slot concept, multiple channel concept, and the channel hopping concept. Also, they have proposed in this amendment 5 MAC behavior modes depending on the different types of application. They have suggested to use different modes. So TSCH is one of them. And the kind of application they have suggested is the equipment monitoring or device monitoring, process automation. So these are the type of activities we can, these are the type of application in which we can use this time slotted channel hopping mode of MAC behavior mode. There are other 4. I am not going into those 4 because my whole work will concentrate on this TSCH. Now you can understand easily time slotted access is there, time slotted, and there are few shared slots, few dedicated slots. So the dedicated slot is given to one sender receiver pair, or sometimes you will call it a link. I will come to the link part in the next slide. And shared access shared slots will be given to all. And these shared slots, the protocol is also different. Dedicated slot protocol is different. Communication protocol is different. Okay. Multi-channel communication. We will see in the initial version before this E amendment, they used to have only one channel. Now later on they are using the 16 channel, and as we will have the 16 channel, so obviously multi-channel communication is possible there, and this increases the network capacity. Channel hopping features, we will see as multiple channels are there, so channel hopping feature also become possible. Channel hopping means one dedicated, any channel will not be dedicated to any node or someone. Basically the sender and receiver pair, or so you can say the link, will change its channel time to time so that anybody will not be able to understand except these two nodes, except these pairs. Anybody will not be able to understand which channel is specifically being used at this moment for communication. So this will, with respect to security, it is very good, because channel hopping will create the problem for the jammer. And also, if we do not consider the security also, the effect of interference and multipath threading also got reduced because of this channel hopping features. This is actually showing that, okay, these are the different slots, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Now here, another concept is the slot frame, means n number of slots together are considered as the slot frame, and this slot frame, the behavior or the schedule will be designed for this slot frame accordingly. This slot frame will be repeated over time. So again, it is in this way, it will be repeated. And the duration of one time slot is given in such a way that at least one sender and receiver can transmit that they exchange that data. Exchange in the sense that the transmit the data and got the acknowledgement. So the remaining offset time and switching time, all these, considering all these, because this offset, switching period, okay, so stop. So all these considering all the periods, that this is the time length for single slot, for a slot. So as I told that, okay, there are two things. One thing is the multiple channels, and if we and the time. So if we represent them in a two-dimensional graph, then we will see that basically in x dimension we are representing the time, and y dimensional y-axis we can say we are representing the channel offset. So in this channel offset and x dimension, it is a slot offset. So this slot offset and channel offset together considered as a link, represented as a link, and or sometimes it is called the cell. So this cell, so if this cell is could be the dedicated cell or could be the shared cell, as I have mentioned already. In case of dedicated cell, so if I consider this is the topology and on node L wants to communicate with P, and it is given this cell as mentioned in this, no one else is there. So obviously, so this is in this communication, it is dedicated one, means L will be able to transmit the data to B without any collision, without any interference, anything. So this is, and for shared, see the two link is given the same shell. E to C, two communication is given the same cell, E to C and G to C. So obviously we need to have the contention to understand that whether E will get the opportunity or G will get the opportunity. So in dedicated links or dedicated cell, the communication is straightforward without any disturbance, and in shared cell, need to perform the contention. One more thing from this that we can understand that, okay, this is the schedule, whether in this cell L to B, in this cell B to E, in this cell D to A. So this is the schedule, and this schedule is needs to be prepared by someone, and it will be informed to the node, so that node will follow this. And the channel hopping, as I mentioned, so that let us consider from this diagram, try to understand, just no need to concentrate on the equation, try to understand here in that diagram. Okay, let us consider that cell 3 slot offset, channel offset 1. This cell is repeated in every slot frame, because this is 0th slot frame, this is first, this is second, third. In every slot frame, this same cell is repeated. And now let us consider this cell is given to a node for communicating with its parent. So now this node, what frequency or what channel it will use basically for communication? So it will be decided by this equation, and this equation follows the channel hopping mechanism. So by that, what will happen when it is in the slot frame 0? Let it is using channel 5. When it is in the slot frame 1, it is using channel 9. Similarly, when it is in slot frame 2, it is using channel 13. So that means you can understand one single cell is given, slot offset is same, channel offset is same, is given to the source and destination, means one link for communicating, maybe A to B, node A to B for this. And they are sending the data. When first data packet, it is going to use channel 5, second data packet going to use channel 9. So not a fixed channel. So this is the channel hopping, and this channel hopping is decided following this equation. Now this channel hopping actually creates the problem that we will see on, because the synchronization is important. Both of them needs to be synchronized. Otherwise, when the sender, let us consider sender is moving from channel 5 to channel 9, the receiver is maybe moving to 5 to 13. So that will be the problem. Then in the second slot frame, one node sender is in the channel 9, receiver is in the channel 13, obviously communication is not possible. So now coming to the open issues, which are available here, network formation related issues are there, link scheduling, just scheduling what I have told, scheduling is there, synchronization, just before this slide I told about the synchronization. Application specific QA, security related issue, all are already open issues. I am focusing in this presentation on the network formation related issues. So now I am coming to that network formation part. First, I will explain how the network formation is happening and what are the problems, and then few solutions. Network formation will be started by the joint register and coordinator node, which is, you know, in any network, someone must be the responsible to start the process. So joint register and coordinator, JRC, is in short we call it is JRC. JRC will start. How it is start? It is starting. It is basically sending the beacon, and it is applicable for any kind of network, not only the low power network. It is sending the beacon, and in 6TiSCH network, another packet also required to participate, or you can say that to be associated with the network. That is the DIO. So that is nothing but the network routing related information is present in this DIO, and inside this beacon, network related information, slot frame length, structure, and duration, so all this, the initial information is present in the beacon. So this, in this right side, I have shown one diagram that there are A, B, C, D, E, F. These are new nodes. Sometimes we call it as a place. The new node is also called as a place according to the terminology of IEEE. So now these places are waiting to get the EB and DIO from the JRC. So everyone is not in the communication range of the JRC. So those who are present inside the communication range of the JRC, they will start getting this EB and DIO first. So first, obviously, it will get the beacon. So now once it will get the beacon, then it will wait for the DIO. But here the problem comes. Why? The problem is, so let us consider node A is waiting for the EB. But in which channel it will wait? At the parallelly, it cannot wait for EB in all the 16 channels, because JRC is sending the EB in a particular channel, a particular time instant. So now A needs to match with that channel, needs to sense in that same channel, then only it will be able to get the EB. Otherwise, even though EB is present, EB is being transmitted by the JRC, node A will not get it. So that is the one important point we should keep in mind, because that will come in again in the problem. So when it will match, means the new node is sensing in the channel, maybe in channel X, and coordinator, a JRC, is also transmitting the beacon in the same channel X. Then new node will get it. And once it will get, it will understand the, you know, all the required parameters, and it will get synchronized with the network. So this is the synchronization. And then let us represent it by this yellow color, synchronized node. Now it is waiting for the DIO. And in between, before getting the DIO, there is a process, JRQ and JRS joint request, joint response communication. This is required to perform the security related activities. So now keeping aside the security part, let us consider the security part is done. It is waiting for the DIO. And now once it will get the DIO, it will join the network successfully. Now this node A becomes the green node, so that means the join node. So following the same fashion, now A has it is join node already, so A is able to transmit the EB and DIO to further extension of the network. In this way, it will go on. The network formation will be completed once all the new nodes, all the places, will join the network. So this is all nodes has become green, and then obviously it will be decided who is the parent. That means the topology will be decided accordingly. That's why the DIO is required. The DIO is coming corresponding to the network routing protocol, RPL, DUDAC. Okay, so destination oriented directed acyclic graph, it is being formed here. So that arrow is showing here the directed acyclic graph. So this is the completion of the process. Now, what is the problem in this process? Already I told about this channel matching. Sender receiver needs to be in the same channel. Second is that according to the RFC 8180, this only one shell, shared shell, which is used for control packet transmission. Rest of the cells are dedicated cell, they will be used for data communication. So now for this control packet communication, you can see EB, DIO, JRS, JRQ, and few more. Keep alive packet is also there. So all these control packets needs to be transmitted in the same cell, only one cell available. So congestion is very high. So that is the problem. And now we have analyzed this using a Markov chain model. I am not going into this Markov chain model, but yes, to timing, when only EB packet has been received by the new node, we call it as a TSCH formation or synchronization time. And when EB and DIO both are received, it is called the 6 TISCH formation time. So that we will show in our results. Now this is the work we have done, and this is C2DBI. I am coming to the work directly. According to the RFC, we have tried to analyze the performance that traditional we have observed. This is our observation that, okay, when the number of nodes joining one by one, the joining time, average joining time, initially it degrades and then it is increasing. Similarly, in case of beacon interval, so again, we have seen if we change the beacon interval, because we have seen the beacon interval is used to transmit the beacon. If we change the beacon interval, then we observe similar pattern with respect to joining time here in the second. And energy consumption also, what we have understood that, okay, if when the nodes, one by one node is joining, the joined node is increasing, then the energy consumption, overall energy consumption per node or inside the network, every node overall energy consumption is increasing for the new node. Because obviously we can understand that because the joining congestion is increasing, so it is the energy consumption, joining time, everything is increasing. Now how to reduce this? So to wanted to solve this, and we have observed that one of the reason for this increased congestion is the fixed EB interval, fixed beacon interval. So we have thought that, okay, it could be dynamic beacon interval. Now the question coming, how to do this, how to make it dynamic, and when it will be dynamic. So it is not always it is dynamic, it is channel condition based. How it will be decided, the interval will be decided based on the present channel status. If the congestion is less, we are going to use the shorter beacon interval. That means frequent transmission. If the congestion is very high, or you can say the more, then we are going to use the longer beacon interval. That means the transmission will be reduced, the number of transmission will be reduced in a particular period, so that the congestion will be reduced. Now again the question is coming that how to understand that less congestion, more congestion. So we have used the channel business ratio, CBR, to find out the use, or to find out the portion of the time, how much portion of the time a channel is remain busy. So that is the CBR metric. Based on this CBR metric, we have decided the next beacon interval. So following this equation, and the basic philosophy is this one. Less congestion, shorter interval, that means frequent transmission. More congestion, longer interval, so number of transmission will be less in a period. We have analyzed it using the Markov chain model, but I am just not discussing those part. We have also analyzed using the test bed, that is the test bed available to access online. This is FIT IoT lab test bed. We have used that one, and that test bed, using this test bed, what we have understood that yes, C2DBI, in case of this, we have compared with two scheme basically. One is the DRA and the RFC, this 6 TISCH MC. with respect to the joining time for TSCH network or 6TSCH network, the CTDBI performs well. From this diagram, you can see. But one thing here, you will see that DRA is having the less time. And DRA is basically not following the traditional method, which is the only one shared cell for each slot frame will be used for all the control packet transmission. This method is not following. So that's why DRA performs better. But we have used here in the comparison to show that if we use multiple shared cell, then the performance will be far much more better than the traditional method. With respect to the energy consumption also, the similar idea, but here one thing is DRA using multiple shared cell in a slot frame. That's why using the DRA, the energy consumption is more than the C2DBI, which is our proposed scheme, and the RFC, which is the 6TISCH MC, minimal configuration. DRA, in case of DRA, the energy consumption is more because it is using multiple shared cell in a slot frame, but the C2DBI and 6TISCH MC using only one shared cell per slot frame. We have found out another problem, that is the opportunistic transmission and control packet. So we have another problem is the starvation. DIO packet starves to get transmitted. And what is the reason for this starvation? The highest priority is given to the beacon. It is everywhere. It is in all network. The highest priority is given to the beacon packet. But this logic creates the problem here. And we have tried to analyze that whatever we are thinking is correct or not. So first we have tried to analyze, or you can say correctness, we have tried to prove that yes, whatever we are thinking is correct. EB has highest priority, EB has equal priority with other control packets. So we have done this experiment, we have observed that yes, the joining time is more if we have the EB highest priority. If EB has the equal priority with other control packets, then the joining time, average joining time is less. And then the question is coming, okay, now how to handle this issue? So the issue we have tried to solve in this way, that okay, whenever highest priority is needed to be given to EB, it will be given. Otherwise, you should give to the DIO packet because two packets are required, right? DIO and EB. So EB is basically disturbing to be transmitted, the DIO packet to be transmitted by the node. EB is disturbing because once both the packets are available in the buffer, node will pick up the highest priority packet and will transmit. And DIO will be in the queue forever. So that we have modified it, that okay, EB will be given to the highest priority whenever it will be required. DIO will be given to the highest priority whenever it will be required. But again, the question is coming, how to decide? So the solution is when we are receiving a request for DIO, then give the priority to the DIO. So this request is transmitted by DIS packet. Again, I have written the short form, DIS packet is the request packet. And another clue is the whenever a node is receiving JRQ frame. So in both the cases, give the highest priority to DIO so that the EB will not disturb the DIO to be transmitted. Another issue in the same work, we have shown that, okay, this DIO transmission or DIO generation interval is handled by the trickle algorithm. Now this trickle algorithm has a negative effect. What is this negative effect? Trickle algorithm increases the DIO interval whenever the network is stable enough. So it is increasing in doubling the interval basically. So for if the network is stable, then this DIO interval could be the maximum. It could go up to the maximum limit. And now the question is here, if it is going to the higher range, DIO interval, then any node, now any node who is joining right now or who wants to join right now needs to wait for a long time. So that is the negative effect of the trickle algorithm. But trickle algorithm was designed keeping in mind the energy consumption, not keeping in mind the duration, time duration. So again, we have tried to make it that whether we are thinking is correct. We have tried to understand, yes, from this analysis, we have understood that trickle algorithm based DIO interval is performing worse than the fixed DIO interval. If we do not increase the DIO interval in this way, doubling the interval following the trickle algorithm. So the question then again coming in picture that, okay, how to solve this problem? The solution is, okay, you reset the trickle algorithm interval whenever it is required. Now the question is again, whenever it is required, when it is required, how to know? So the answer is given in this, when the node is receiving the JRQ, then you reset this. In the same work, another problem is corresponding to the CSMSCA that, okay, this is a well-known protocol. It is used in random channel access, for example, the Wi-Fi is using CSMSCA, but here also it is used in the shared shape because that is the shared one. Everyone needs to contend for getting the access. So CSMSCA protocol is used, and here the CSMSCA protocol creates the problem, which is there, its traditional problem, uncertainty in accessing the shared slot. Okay, so now how to reduce this? Because in low power and lossy network, energy consumption is very important concept, a very important requirement, which was not present in, let us consider, in Wi-Fi. So therefore, here what we have done is, okay, a join node does not increase the contention window size. If you know the CSMSCA protocol, then probably you will know that contention window is one of the parameters which is used in CSMSCA. So join node will not increase the contention window size to give the permission to the control packet to transmit very quickly, or to give the more opportunity to be transmitted by the node. Again, the question, same question, that okay, how to understand this, that when we should increase the contention window, when we should not increase the contention window. So the solution is again similar, that whenever a node is receiving the DIS packet, that means DIO request, and whenever they're receiving JRQ frame, in both the cases should not increase the contention window. Rest of the cases we can increase. We have analyzed it, and what we have observed, this proposed scheme performs, OTCP is the short name for this scheme, performs better. Okay, I will just finish in maybe 5 minutes. So I will skip the last one. Let me tell this one, then the last solution I will skip. This is the tactile, another solution we have proposed. Now coming to the problem is that, okay, from this diagram we can understand that this is the shared shell and this is the slot frame length, and this is another slot frame, and this is the first one is the shared, first one is the shared shell, we know this green box. And now when this is the shared, everyone is participating here and all the remaining cells are unused. So these cells are unused. We have tried to utilize this cell to improve the performance. That is the problem. That is the thing. And solution is, we have tried to utilize, we have leveraged these unused cells for improving the performance. Now the solution is two scheme. One is the first allotment, because those cells needs to be allotted, those unused cells needs to be allotted to sender receiver nodes. And then the synchronization is important, because when the sender is in the one cell, if the receiver is in the other cell, then again the synchronization issue will occur. So therefore, two schemes have been proposed. One is the allotment scheme and another is the scheduling scheme. So this is the, in the allotment scheme, what we have used that instead of 00, if you see this previous, this is basically index is 00. Slot offset is 0, channel offset is 0. Instead of 00, giving to all nodes, we are allotting different cells and maximum 3. But at a time, only one cell will be used. At a time cannot be used. Multiple cells cannot be used by a node. So we are giving to all nodes maximum 3 cells to utilize those unused cells. And this C is the allotment scheme. And now the scheduling scheme, when which cell is being used for communication? So scheduling scheme, again, so this is based on the odd even concept. One, you can say color matching problem is also little bit, not exactly. We have taken the influence. We have taken the idea from there. So that is being used here. And scheduling algorithm has been proposed. So these two together, what we have observed that, okay, it performs much better than the our first scheme also, C2DBI. C2DBI we proposed at the beginning. So tactile is this present scheme. This tactile also performs better than traditional RFC, which is 8180, and C2DBI. So C2DBI we proposed in the first problem. And first solution was the C2DBI. The tactile performs much better than them with respect to joining time, with respect to energy consumption, both. So this work, I, because of the time is going to finish, I am just skipping this one. Okay. So now let me come to the testbed part, which I have in this IIT Guwahati. In fact, in our department, it is here just beside me. So all these devices, we are using this Texas Instrument device, which is shown here, Texas Instruments CC2650 sensor tag and launch pad. We are using also Raspberry Pi is there, but these are specifically designed for low power or lossy network that, we are using those devices for running the experiment, whatever protocol we are proposing, whatever network formation scheme we are proposing. So those things we actually compile and then flush in these devices and we test the results accordingly. So this is our lab for IEEE 802.15.4 following this specification. And also I have the LoRa test bed. Those means few students, my MTech students are working in LoRa based application. So they use this test bed. So these are the test bed I have. And this is all about the network formation in 60ISCH network, recent advancement. We have proposed few more solutions also. And that has been also published already. And few are in the queue already. It is submitted, but under review. That's all from my side. Okay, thank you. And now it is open for all for any question and answer.
Thank you, Professor Manas, for an insightful talk. We can take a few questions now.
I had a question, Dr. Manas. This is Peetam here. This experiments with different MAC strategies, does the TI chipset allow you to change this MAC protocols, or do you need something more custom like a do radio to implement some of this and test it?
Different MAC protocols means yes, we are using the TSCH version, but we are changing few parameters. We have, as I have mentioned, few settings, so that is allowed. But different radio, that I don't know whether it will allow or not, different using for different band. we are using 2.4 gigahertz bands, that is allowed. But different radio means it has only support for that only. And we are using Contiki operating system, Contiki NG, so that is supported.
So changing this beacon interval and all are is supported?
These are supported. And those experiments, a few experiments actually we have done using similar node is there in, and similar node is there in FIT IoT lab, which is available in the sense that we can access that lab online. So we have used that lab basically, but yes, in last few experiments, we have used our test bed. And where we have done the same thing, means if we use the Kuja simulator and Contiki NG operating systems, then if we simulate whatever we are doing the simulation, then finally the binary file will be generated. That binary file we can flush here and we can execute here.
Thank you. If there are no other questions, I'll ask another question. When you're talking about these busy slots, does the Mac or the hardware allow you to check how many slots are being used and how many are idle?
Yes. We can get this information from the log file. Means you can, just like our, suppose when we do the simulation, we write different types of logs. Similar log we can write here. And finally, it will generate a log file. From that log file, we have to extract, basically.
But is it available on the runtime? Or you have to be do this analysis on offline mode?
No, on runtime, this information is not given, but because we don't have that facility to perform runtime analysis, we have generated the log file and it is dumped in a system. And then after completion, we have analyzed those logs file.
Okay, thanks.
Are there any other questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, then we can end today's session here. Thank you again, Professor Manas, for agreeing to deliver a talk at CMI seminar series. And as discussed before, we'd like to remind the audience to subscribe to our Google Groups, which is the mailing list for information on future talks. You can also visit our website for more details. The links have already been pasted in the chat box. The link to the recorded video will also be posted on the webpage. Thank you and have a great evening.
Thank you. Bye.